All right, good to see you here today. Look forward to our time of worship together. Bob's going to come and read for us. Good morning. Please turn with me to Psalm 82.
God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked? Defend the poor and fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and needy. Deliver the poor and needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked. They know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said, ye are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. But ye shall die like men, and fall like one of the princes. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. Amen. Gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity to worship you, dear Lord. Thank you for drawing us here. Open our eyes to see Christ and Christ alone, our righteousness. All things have been given to Christ. Father has given him everything, dear Lord. And again, we pray that you be with Ken as he brings forth the message. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's take our bulletins and turn to the inside cover. We'll sing this tune of Amazing Grace.
They stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he knelt down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad to the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentations over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preach Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies, and that were lame were healed. And there was a great joy in that city. But there was a certain man called Simon, which beforetime in the same city used sorcery, and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the great power of God. And to him they had regard, because that of long time he had bewitched them with sorceries. But when they believed Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Then Simon himself believed also, and when he was baptized, he continued with Philip, and wondered, beholding the miracles and signs which were done. Now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John, who, when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. For as yet he was fallen upon none of them, only they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then laid they their hands on them, and they received the Holy Ghost. And when Simon saw that through laying on the apostles' hands the Holy Ghost was given, he offered them money, saying, give me also this power, that on whomsoever I lay hands, he may receive the Holy Ghost. But Peter said unto him, thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money. Thou hast neither part nor lot in this matter, for thy heart is not right in the sight of God. Repent, therefore, of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thy heart may be forgiven thee. For I perceive that thou art in the gall of bitterness, and in the bond of iniquity. Then answered Simon and said, pray ye to the Lord for me, that none of these things which ye have spoken come upon me. And they, when they had testified and preached the word of the Lord, returned to Jerusalem, and preached the gospel in many villages of the Samaritans. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, arise, and go towards the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of eunuch of great authority under Candaceus, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot, reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him, and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, understandest thou that what thou readest? And he said, how can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. The place of the scripture which he read was this: he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearers, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this, of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth, and they began at the same scripture, and preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came into a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doeth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariots to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord called away Philip, and that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you now and we thank you for the word. Lord, we ask you to put it in our heart that we may understand what we read, Lord. Lord, we know that you appoint all the times, bounds, and habitations for your purpose and for us to seek you, Lord. Lord, we ask you to be with Brother Ken today as he delivers the word. Open our hearts to that word. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
I love to read the story, Lord. Cause his word to go forth. Let's take our hymn books and sing hymn number 40. Great is thy faithfulness. We'll stand and sing this together. Hymn number 40.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, thy Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and the peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Thank you. May be seated. Let's take our Bibles and look together in John chapter 1. We continue our study through this gospel according to John, the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, but the gospel according to how the Spirit directed John the Apostle to write this inspired word. My text today is from verse 24 down to verse 28. We have John being questioned by the Pharisees as to who he is. They were enthralled with him. more so than the one that John came to foretell. And that's often the case when eyes are still blinded. They look to the preacher rather than to the one that the preacher's proclaiming. May the Lord ever give us eyes to Christ. I'm just like John, a voice crying in the wilderness. And boy, is it a wilderness today. Darkness and dryness as far as the knowledge of Christ is concerned. But I thank God for this place where the world drives by and doesn't even give it second thought. There aren't a lot of cars in the parking lot. It's not a great, great big building that would even attract people's eyes. But if we're here, it's because the Lord has so drawn our hearts and we want to hear of Christ. And so here in verse 24, it says, and they which were sent were of the Pharisees. That in of itself is a reminder that what stands opposed to Christ and his gospel is often the religious people, religious world. They're jealous. They want the attention. And so when one comes with no attention to them and giving all of the attention to the Lord Jesus Christ, initially they approach out of curiosity, but then ultimately out of contention. When they realize that this gospel of Christ gives man no glory whatsoever, and that it's all unto the Son who came, lived, died, rose again, ascended on high, that God might be just to justify, they're going to oppose because it does not give man any part in this matter of salvation. But they continue to ask. And so you can see here the line of reasoning. All right, so you're not Elijah and you're not one of the other prophets like Moses said the Lord would raise up. And you're not even the Messiah, but you come to be the forerunner of that Messiah, then by what authority do you do what you do? I find this line of reasoning still continues today. If you're not one from one of their denominational schools, if you haven't been raised under their teaching, then by what authority do you do what you do? I hear this all the time about our congregation. People want to know, well, you've got to be part of some organization. And there's got to be somebody that directs you. You can't just be a congregation that the Lord has gathered together and for that one purpose to worship Christ and him crucified. And they marvel when you keep coming back to it. No, that's it. It's not about plans or programs or what I call the bees, the buses, and the budgets, and the Bibles, and baptisms, and everything else that everybody's counting. And like, what? Who are you? By what authority do you preach? By what organization do you come? And that's what they said here in verse 25. They asked him and said unto him, and that said is a strong statement. It's not that they were asking to learn. There's times when people ask questions, you can tell right away, they're not asking to hear, to learn. They're making a statement by their question. And this was their statement. Why baptizest thou then if thou be not that Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet? And John answered them, saying, I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom ye know not. And that's a pretty clear statement right there. You can judge by people's questions whether they have learned of Christ or not, or sat under somebody that's pointing them to Christ, because they get all caught up with other things. They want to be able to go back, well, you know, who are those historically that you identify with, or what catechism or confession of faith do you follow? Those are always those questions because that's how they've been trained. You've got to be either Baptist, you've got to be Pentecostal, you've got to be Presbyterian, you've got to be Episcopal, you've got to be something. And the simple statement was, I baptize with water. And that's what I want us to see here. What was John's baptism all about? Because this was something new. The Pharisees had their traditions. They had their ceremonies, they had their rituals, they had what they called baptisms. which was, because the word baptize here means to immerse. But what they taught was if you went out in the marketplace, for example, and touched hands with the world out there, it's interesting now they're telling everybody to wash your hands, but that you were in contact with the world. When you came back, there was a ceremonial way of dipping your fingers up to a certain point in joints, immersing them in the water, and by their being purified. And so here again, men have their traditions, but what John was doing was so distinct and so different from anything they had ever seen before. It didn't follow the traditions of men. And so they were wondering, what is it then that you do? John here is simply saying, this is baptism with water. Water does not in any way purify anybody. You can take a dead sinner and dunk them into the water and bring him out, because that's what immersion is. If we truly understand baptism for what the word means, that it means to immerse, the translators chose to just transliterate the word from the Greek. The Greek gets the word baptizo, from which we get baptized. But you can take a person and dunk them in the water and bring them out, and all you've done is put a dead sinner in the water and brought out a dead, wet sinner. That's it. I baptized with water. That was what he was saying. The key here, people are all caught up with John's baptism, and they miss what he's stating here, but there standeth one among you whom ye know not. So he's letting them know that this baptism is not that in which you put your trust, but it is who this baptism, this immersion represents. There is one standing here among you, that standeth one among you whom ye know not. This is an interesting thing when you consider at this point that John was speaking, because you'll notice absent from this particular portion of scripture is the part where Christ himself was baptized. That's over in Matthew, where he saw the Spirit descending and remained upon him. You can see in verse 32. We'll get to that next time. This had already occurred when we're reading what happened here. And John is reminding them, because they were coming to him even after Christ himself had been baptized, to show that he was that Messiah. And you can see the next day, we'll see this next time, John saw Jesus coming. This Jesus coming, said unto him, behold the Lamb of God. He'd already been manifest as that one who should come. But these others now coming lately who perhaps had not been there, John repeats the story. In verse 30, this is he whom I said, after me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not. Not in the fullness of his person and glory until it was manifest, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. Again, he's not putting the emphasis on the baptism with water, but on the one that it represents, that who should come, that was foretold. And John bare them record, saying, so now he's telling them what they obviously had already missed when Christ had come to him to baptize him. I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him. See, that's who he is the Christ. It's the anointing of the Spirit, and that was represented here by the dove from heaven. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remain on him, the same is he which baptizes with the Holy Ghost. And he says, I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. That's why I say at this point, this had already occurred. You can go back and read about it in Matthew chapter 3. But what we're reading here is John again. His testimony doesn't change. You can tell that a man has been taught of God to preach Christ the truth, because his testimony doesn't change. It doesn't matter how many ways people try to get at it. He keeps coming back to exactly what was revealed concerning Christ. And he declares that. he it is. So he's telling them right there, but there standeth one among you. Doesn't mean that the Lord was necessarily right in that crowd, but he's already out doing his work and preaching the kingdom and calling sinners to repentance. It's to him that you're to go, not to me. So not only did he here turn people's attention away from himself, but also away from the baptism itself. People want to make an idol out of baptism. In fact, today there are people that are traveling all the way over there to that part of the world. And each one has a determination as to what this exact spot is where he was baptized. That's what's of interest to them, where it says there, as he said in verse 27, he it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latch, and I'm not worthy to unloose, not even as a servant. And it says these things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing. So guess what people are doing? They're trying to find out where Bethabara was. It's a place that doesn't even exist anymore today, but boy, if you go over there, so they tell me, there's all kinds of shrines. And there's people that are traveling all that distance, paying all that money, so they can be dunked in the same water, in the same place where John was baptizing, and that somehow makes it more important and more valuable. Even some going over there that don't believe in immersion, but they're getting vials of this water and this from this place and bringing it back and using it to sprinkle. What they call holy water. Even there, it shows that men have made an idol. And that's what we would do. Make an idol out of men, make an idol out of history, make an idol out of ceremonies. What really confounds them is when you come over here to John chapter 4. Well, it's actually John chapter 3, first of all. It says, after these things came Jesus and his disciples unto the land of Judea, and there he tarried with them and baptized. Verse 23, and John also was baptized in Anon near to Salem. So now we got a problem. Well, was it over here in this Bethabara? Was it over here in Anon? Which is it? It says, because there was much water there. So again, to those that say, well, the mode isn't important. You can just sprinkle. Why would there need to be much water? Even in Christ's baptism, it says he went down in the water and came out. Because of what it depicts. Baptism in itself does not save. And John's baptism, that's why he said, I baptized with water. He was minimizing the act itself for who it represents. And what the baptism, scriptural baptism, represents is the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why they're plunged into the water. And then the rising again, which is the coming forth out of the water. It's the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that being necessary for the redemption. There's no redemption in the water, but the redemption of those sinners that Christ came to save. And so even here, you have to realize John is still part of the Old Testament. He's the last Old Testament prophet. Christ had not yet earned that righteousness that was necessary to save his people. He had not yet shed his blood. So just like in the Old Testament, you had the types and pictures and prophecies and promises that were foreshadowing that work that he came, that's what this baptism represented, the foreshadowing, the foretelling of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why he was baptized by John. Even though initially John hesitated, it's not for cleansing. Christ didn't need cleansing. It wasn't for any kind of imperfection that now the water is going to take care of. The water washes over the body and that's it. It has nothing to do in any way with any kind of personal perfection or purity or purification, but it's a picture. It's like the Old Testament sacrifices. The slaying of those animals was a picture of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ that he should die. So John, right now, in this position that he is in, standing where he does at this moment in history, as the last of the Old Testament prophets, he's still foretelling. But the only difference is for John now, here was that one that all of those of the Old Testament desired to see but didn't. They died without ever having received the promise of his coming. But now John, and that's why he was declared to be the greatest among men, because that which those Old Testament prophets desired to see, here he was seeing him and declaring him and that work that he should accomplish. But here again in verse 23, you say, well, why Enon here? Why over here does it say Bethabara? Well, John was preaching all up and down that river, that Jordan. And he was on the other side, which again we saw last time. He wasn't in Jerusalem doing this. This already was an evidence that those things pertaining to that old Jerusalem were passing away. That the significance was, he wasn't going to come and try to blend in the message that he was given to preach concerning Christ with all of those other religious ceremonies. It was by Christ. He suffered outside the gate. That was a condemnation of everything that was taking place with old Jerusalem. Sure, it was necessary for a time. But once Christ came and fulfilled all that was written of him in the law concerning his person, his work, that old religious Jerusalem has no more significance. No more, but men are stubborn. They're blind. They still, even after having crucified the Lord Jesus Christ, went back there and sewed up that veil that had been rent in twain and continued in complete rebellion and antagonism to the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ, worshiped there in Jerusalem. And God, in his forbearance, allowed that for 40 years, from the time where Christ was crucified until the time where he brought in the Roman armies and destroyed that city and the temple and forever. And it's been that way ever since. That it's not the old Jerusalem that we're to look to, but the new Jerusalem, which is that city that speaks of Abraham, who looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. That's Christ. He is the temple. He is the great high priest. And his is that sacrifice, which is the fulfillment of all these others. So these were coming out from where they were and coming to John and questioning him. I often say this, that we don't need to go to people's places of worship to try to win them over. The Lord has separated us out. If he's going to draw them, he's going to draw them out. There's no mixture in this message with what's going on in the world's religion today. Even as with John, there was no mixture. There was no trying to put new wine in old wineskins. That his one purpose in coming and baptizing with water was that they might know in verse 26 that this all pointed to that one among them whom they did not know. You have to understand that it's not going to be by reasoning that any are going to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. It's going to be by revelation. Even though they had the scriptures, even though they had the very Old Testament from which John was preaching, because when he declared there his message, behold the Lamb of God, that had to be a bell ringer in their minds and ears and hearing it, because up to then, the lambs were those which were sacrificed. And yet now he's speaking of the Lamb of God. This is the fulfillment of what the Lord said to Abraham as he took Isaac up on that Mount Moriah, back there in Genesis 22. And Mount Moriah was the place where years later, God caused the Temple of Solomon to be built. So all of this has significance in its progression. And yet, when Isaac, directed by the Spirit, said to his father, well, I see the wood, I see the fire, but where's the lamb? That's a beautiful question. Where's the lamb? Every scripture rightly set forth and proclaimed tells sinners where's the lamb. In the Old Testament, type, picture, prophecy, promise, the New Testament fulfillment. And that's what this is all about. It's not to make an idol out of baptism. It's not to make an idol out of the Lord's table, those elements. Others call that the sacraments, which is a blasphemy, because the word sacrament means a sacred. They consider sacred what they call the baptism, but for many it's just sprinkling water on somebody. Or they take the cup and it's all fixed up in gold, all the elements around it. And people look to that as something that by partaking now, they're actually partaking of the grace of God. It's all in those elements, such as the idolatry of our hearts. And we would be right in there with them, lined up in the front of the line, were it not for the Spirit of God having taught us otherwise. So I don't want to minimize the importance of baptism. As Robert was reading over there in Acts chapter 8, you'll notice that what John here was set forth to do by the Lord's instruction, because he didn't come up with this on his own. This was something new, but so was the ushering in of the new bread and the new wine, the new kingdom, in the fulfillment of the Lord Jesus Christ. So this is a clear departure from all of the traditions of the Old Testament customs. But here in Acts chapter 8, I don't know, as Robert was reading that, if you noticed the place of baptism, of water baptism. Some people ask, well, what's the difference between John's baptism and ours today? There's no difference other than his foretold that Christ should come, live, die, and rise again. Now, by our being baptized in water immersed, we're looking back to that which was accomplished. He did come. He did lay down his life. He did rise again. He did ascend on high. And the work of redemption and justification is accomplished. And so this practice now of immersion, because the Pharisees had their ceremonies. If a Gentile, what they call a proselyte, wanted to be part of the Jewish kingdom, then they had to go through these ceremonies. And they had a ceremony that they called baptism, but it wasn't anything like this. That's why these were asking, well, what is this? What is this all about? And because of the enmity, the line that was drawn then between what the Pharisees were promoting and what the scriptures were declaring of Christ, because of that enmity, you have to understand that for somebody in that day to get down in that water, they were identifying with this disdained and hated Jesus of Nazareth. So it wasn't just a performance. I think I'll go get baptized today. No, it meant a death. You're identifying with Christ in the water of death, in which he himself was immersed. His death is called a baptism, an immersion. But in so doing, you're cutting yourself off with the rest of the religious world. This meant something. And so even here is in Acts 8, as Robert was reading it, it says in verse 12, when they believed. So this is not a matter of just taking anybody and dumping. Just to improve your number, say how many you had baptized. When they believed, and where does faith originate? It's by the Spirit of God. And what is faith? It's the Spirit revealing Christ in that sinner. Upon believing, Philip preaching, notice the things concerning the kingdom of God. That was his message, just like John the Baptist. Yes, he was called to baptize, but it wasn't his message. Just like Paul, when to the Corinthians he wrote, and people started dividing sides and saying, well, I was baptized by Paul, and I was baptized by Peter. Paul said, Christ did not send me to baptize. He couldn't even remember how many he had baptized in his time, but to preach Christ and him crucified. That's the emphasis. Water baptism by itself is not salvation. There have been many, even here in Acts 8, you read where that one Simon, when he saw that through the laying on the hands of the apostles, the Holy Ghost was given, he lined up. I'm going to go through this and be immersed and all of these things. But ultimately, he was exposed. That's what Peter told him in verse 22, repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. If perhaps, in other words, if Christ has paid your debt, it is, but if not, all of this you're going through isn't going to save you one whit. And it says there, therefore. So notice first, they believed. That's the work of the Spirit of God in the heart, revealing Christ in the heart. And I believe even as John testified here, seeing him as all, having nothing in ourselves, that this one who is preferred before me, he's preferred before all. He's the King of kings, the Lord of lords. He's the Redeemer, he's the Justifier, he's the Sanctifier. That one that the Spirit causes us to believe on, it says there that preaching the kingdom of God, the kingship of God, the sovereignty of God in Christ, this isn't man's will, but all the glory going to Christ, and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Not in order to be saved, but because the Lord's Spirit had done that work in revealing Christ in them. The same with Philip, when he was directed there to the Ethiopian eunuch. He was the minister of the treasury of Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians at that time, that the Lord had directed to Jerusalem and procured there a scroll, a copy of the book of Isaiah. And when, verse 29, the Spirit said to Philip, go near and join thyself to this chariot. See, all of this shows a prior work of the Spirit in the heart. Philip didn't go all that way to get one more notch in his belt of having gotten another one he baptized. No. It says, Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah. You know, Philip even himself, hearing the reading, his heart would have leaped, not even knowing necessarily what the Lord might do or not do. That's the way it is with me. When I hear the word read, even by the men that stand here and read, or I'm reading for my, this is my need. And my heart leaps when I read the book of Isaiah and see how it all pertains to Christ. But he asks him, understandest thou what thou readest? And he said in verse 31, how can I except some man should guide me? It shows again how God has purposed to use men, his prophets, down through the years, his preachers, to guide. We're not the ones converting sinners, but to guide them to the Lord Jesus Christ. And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. That's another indication that the Lord's Spirit was already at work in him. First of all, that he was reading the scriptures and had some understanding or desire to. And secondly, when the Lord sent him a preacher, that he would desire to come and sit with him. And the place of the scripture which he read was this. You have to remember, they didn't have chapters and verses. This is a scroll. So he's unfolding this to get to that place of scripture which was read. And it says, he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. That's taken right from Isaiah 53 and verse 7. And his humiliation, his judgment was taken away, and who shall declare his generation? For his life was taken from the earth. I love the questions. Even these questions indicate the Spirit's at work. This is not Philip sitting down saying, well, let me go through the ABCs now of salvation, and we can get this done quickly. No. The eunuch answered Philip, verse 34, and said, I pray thee, don't you love this, of whom speaketh the prophet this? That's the key for me. Not of what, not just interested in historic facts, but of whom? Did he speak this of himself or of some other man? That much the Lord had given him that understanding. And boy, what a blessing now that Philip opened his mouth and began at that same scripture and preached unto him Jesus, the man, the God-man. Consider the man is the way the writer to the Hebrews puts it. This one who came in the flesh, God in the flesh, to work out that salvation that God might be just and justified. Oh, what a blessing. I remember when the Lord first opened my eyes, because I've been trained in every other part of the Bible, but the man, heard about a man, talked about, but Now to go back and see that no matter where you turn in Scripture, it's about this man, the God-man, the representative, the Savior. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized, to be immersed? I'm confident that even as Philip here was pointing this one to the Lord Jesus Christ, he was also declaring unto him how it is that one that the Lord has taught identifies with that Christ. It's not in all of these shenanigans that you see going on where you get people coming down front, people raising their hands or bowing their head or going through all of these different works of men. No. The way today, I've had people ask me, well, you don't give invitations. Well, not like the world does. And plus, the gospel's not an invitation. It's an exhortation. It's a command to look to Christ and believe on him. And on that basis, when the Lord Jesus Christ has done that work of grace in the heart, that's when that individual is going to desire to identify with the Lord. Well, how do they do it? It's not standing up in a meeting and giving a testimony. It's not coming down front and shaking the preacher's hand. It's in the waters of baptism. And so that's where the eunuch then asks, what doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, here's the key. If thou believest with all thine heart. That's not just believing, but again, based on what was declared of Christ, believing that this Christ is the Savior. This Christ is the substitute. His righteousness is all of the righteousness of acceptance before God the Father. Works in completely excluded. And he answered and said, I believe. Notice this, verse 37. This is not just some general belief. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. There's a lot in that statement. That he is who he says he is. He is who all the scriptures declare him to be. And apart from him, I have no other. I have no hope. I have no righteousness. I have no forgiveness. Except for that when he died for me. So that's how this is taught throughout the rest of the New Testament. You can see this practice, that which began here with John the Baptist as a forthtelling of the work that the Lord Jesus Christ should have accomplished. But then after he had paid the debt, there's two things that the Lord has left his church that he came to redeem. That's the Lord's table, and those elements of the cup and the bread represent his body and his blood shed, and baptism, which again represents the same thing. It's his death, burial, and resurrection. That's it. Those are the pictures that he's given. And we see that practiced by the early church in Acts chapter 2. As they were gathered together, notice again the order in verse 41. When they that gladly received his word were baptized. There's a lot even in gladly received his word. There's a joy. There's a rejoicing. It's not just a performance at all. It's a persuasion. That yes, this one who came, lived, and died, it was on behalf of such a sinner, a wretch as I am. The fact that he had to come, live, and die was that there was no righteousness in me. It was in him. And so that they that gladly received his word, they that gladly received the word, that is Christ. I can remember back in the day, you know, I call it my dunking. When I was first dunked as a 15-year-old boy, well, they put us through the ropes before they would dunk you. You had to follow this baptismal course. And so you had to learn scripture. And it was like a 6-week course to make sure that you had everything lined up. And then we're going to dunk you. And then afterward, you're going to join a new member class. And you're going to continue. We're going to stay on you just to make sure you're walking like you're supposed to. That's what you do with dead bodies. You line them up and get them all propped up. But what happens? If you ever get your hands off that dead body, it's going to go, it's going to fall right over. There's no life in it. When you go back there to Acts 8, once this was all done, Philip turned the Ethiopian eunuch loose. He didn't tell him how. When you get back there to Ethiopia, you better find you a place. at least be in church on Sunday, and that's important. He commended them to the very same Lord that revealed Christ in him. That's the way it is. But so here, when it says, they that gladly received his word, you can't keep quiet. Because I had other people ask, well, if you never give an invitation, how are you going to know when the Lord's doing a work in the heart? They'll tell you. And it's not just that they want to be baptized. They're going to tell you, first of all that Christ has been made to them. It's like we sang in the earlier hour, Christ is made to me, all I need, all I need. That's the confession. It doesn't take any convincing. You're hearing this and you're thinking, just like the Ethiopian eunuch, what doth hinder me to be baptized? That's what I listen for. Who is your rejoicing? Who is your hope? Who is your salvation? So when they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. That's quite a congregation. In fact, it got so big, close to maybe some 25,000. They couldn't meet in one place. They didn't have these big monstrosities of buildings back then. Everybody met in homes. They went from home to home. Until you get to Acts 8, where the Lord sent persecution, scattered them all. The Lord's not in the business of just building big congregations and numbers like men are. Now, here was about 3,000 souls that were added to that local congregation there in Jerusalem. But what does it say? Verse 42, and they continued steadfastly. The same Christ that had been revealed in them and caused them to look to him alone for their salvation, they continued steadfastly. Notice, in the apostles' doctrine, not doctrines. What was the apostles' doctrine? Christ and him crucified. Paul said, I determined not to know anything save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And fellowship, you don't have to organize fellowship or force it. We got to better get along. No, if Christ has done that work, we're going to know it. Our fellowship is with the Father in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And in breaking of bread, some say that that was just the every common day eating together, but it can also be a reference to the Lord's table. You're baptized once to identify with Christ in his baptism, but oh, the joy of being able to regularly, on a regular basis, continue to break bread with one another and rejoice and celebrate in this one who gave his life for sinners such as we are. And in prayers, that word prayers means in the sense of worship. I don't know about you, but I look forward to these times of worship. We spend too much time already out there in the workaday world, and if the Lord gives us the opportunity to come aside, it's like you hear people saying, I'm going to go pamper myself. I'm going to go for a sauna today. I need to just get away for a while. Well, our getting away is when we get together spiritually. And we worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And just how refreshing. I don't know about you, but it moved me to sing even at him. Great is thy faithfulness. O Lord, my Father. We're addressing these words together, singing together. If it's not in your heart, shut up. Just stand there and stare. These are hymns that are given to the Lord's people. Rejoice in him who has done the work. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. That's what John here was all about. He speaks of Christ. It's like he says elsewhere, he must increase, I must decrease. Oh, that would be the case. Even our times of worship. When people ask, well, what did you learn today at church? That's what they. One answer, we learned of Christ once again by his grace and by his mercy. But who is he to you? Well, he's the one who's preferred before me and whose shoes left, I'm not even worthy to unloose. That's what John said. He's talking there about the work of a servant. When someone would come in for a visit, the first thing they would do is take those shoes off and wash their feet because of the dryness. John's saying, I'm not even worthy to be a servant of this one that I declare unto you. And that's how it is with any that the Lord has taught. I truly believe that he indeed received all the glory. All right, let's take a hymn number 118. We'll stand and sing this together. Lord has opened our eyes. Oh, how precious is this hymn. When I survey the wondrous cross, how are we going to survey except eyes to see? Hymn number 118.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss, and more content on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the main things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood. See from his head, his hands, his feet, sorrow and love flow mingled now. Bitter such love and sorrow meet, or thorns come both so rich a crown. Were the whole realm of nature mine, that were a present far too small. Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my own.
All right, we'll look forward to next time. Lord willing.